including international reserves and fiscal markers. Allow me to illustrate this point with a story from our experience over the last few years. I begin by pointing out that the IMF, and not only the IMF, felt that the preconditions for inflation targeting in Russia were very poor in the early 2000s. Many of the problems we faced were quite standard for emerging markets. Our financial markets were deep enough and poorly segmented. Our market institutions were weak. There was a high level of dollarization. Fiscal dominance prevailed. Food and utility prices had an outside share in the consumer prices index. And Russians, largely financially illiterate at the time, were haunted by the memory of persistently high inflation. And that is not an exhaustive list. All of these factors restrained the transmission of monetary policy and inhibited the process of anchoring inflation expectations. Further complicating matter, Russia as an oil exporter suffered from Dutch disease. As a consequence, from time to time, Russia sustained significant terms of trade shocks and exchange rate shocks. It also had excessive private external borrowing. That is why we had to do a lot of preparation. Over the course of 5 years, the Bank of Russia built liquidity management instruments, gradually widened the exchange rate band, and developed in-house modeling and forecasting capacities. I would like to take this opportunity and to thank the IMF for all the technical assistance during that time. But despite all our preparation, there were still doubts about whether we should take the final step and introduce full-fledged inflation targeting and the floating exchange rate. Those doubts only grew after the paper tantrum and two other significant shocks Russia faced in 2014. The first shock was related to the collapse of the oil price. Lest anyone has forgotten, the slide shows exactly what oil prices have done over the last 10 years. Plummeting oil prices required large bounce of payments adjustments. Exports decreased by 40% between 2014 and 2016. A similar correction of imports was needed. The second shock that required adjustments to the balance of payments was geopolitical. That shock caused large capital outflows that were intensified by the forced deleveraging of external debt. You can see just how quickly the Russian banking and corporate sector deleveraged. Our opponents of inflation targeting had two main arguments. One, that inflation targeting isn't appropriate for a commodity exporting country, and two, that it is particularly inappropriate to introduce inflation targeting in a volatile period, as it would significantly increase the exchange rate volatility and destabilize markets. But we believe that the current account shock was precisely why we needed to accelerate the move to inflation targeting. One of the alternative suggestions was to apply capital controls. The Bank of Russia never gave that any thought. We believe capital controls would have a very negative effect in the long run, even if in the short term effect can be positive. If we use such a measure once, investors would expect us to use it again and again. Those kinds of expectations can significantly increase capital outflows and make the job of managing volatility more complicated. I would like to highlight four elements of our policy that proved to be essential in a situation when the central bank has to tackle two issues simultaneously. The first is to achieve its goal, low inflation, through radical change in monetary policy regime, and the second is to preserve financial stability. Those four elements are volatility management, resilience of the banking sector, central bank's independence and effective coordination with the government, and an active communication policy. Allow me now to elaborate. I'll begin with volatility management. The balance of payments shock was particularly acute in our case, because of the combination of the terms of trade shock prompted by the decline in oil prices and the capital account shock due to sanctions. Capital account shocks are common in emerging markets even without sanctions. They usually amplify current account shocks or maybe a result of policy changes in reserve currency countries. Capital account shocks can be quite disruptive as they may cause excessive exchange rate volatility. However, while in the case of terms of trade shocks, exchange rate adjustment usually works as an automatic stabilizer, in the case of capital account shock, this is often not the case due to disruptions of the FX liquidity market and balance sheet effect. Therefore, I think that central banks of countries that are not of reserve currencies need to have not only local currency, but as well as FX liquidity management instruments. Of course, such tools should only be used temporarily to smooth out liquidity shocks rather than to mask actual exchange rate targeting. Finding a source of FX liquidity for central banks is another problem. In our case, we relied on our international reserves. In theory, there are also other sources, ranging from the IMF and regional reserves arrangements and credit lines to sources the Fed or other advanced country central banks. So what did we do to address our volatility problem and adjust the balance of payments while getting inflation under control? First of all, we let the exchange rate adjust freely by switching to a floating exchange rate. While exchange rate volatility initially spiked, it then quickly fell. Furthermore, especially with introduction of a fiscal rule, the exchange rate considerably decoupled from the price of oil. Second, we tightened monetary policy by sharply raising the key rate to 17%. We have retained some tightness of monetary policy since then. That policy allowed us to quickly stabilize inflation and inflation expectations after the initial jump. It also prevented deposit dollarization. That's why in 2016, during the second fall in oil crisis, people and the market reacted much more calmly than they had in 2014. Russians did not rush to the bank to convert their ruble accounts into foreign currency as they had in previous times with uncertainty. A very slow and cautious easing policy, which we have conducted since then, was the main factor that brought inflation down to our 4% target last year. Nonetheless, these two policy measures alone were not enough to resolve the issues with liquidity and volatility. But as I mentioned earlier, we also introduced special FX liquidity tools to deal with companies and banks' abrupt loss of access to the global financial market. The second issue is the financial sector's resilience. In volatile times, the financial sector needs to be resilient enough to withstand shocks and to manage unavoidable credit and interest rate risks. We started working on strengthening the banking sector back in 2013. That policy involving improving regulation and supervision also means ridding the banking sector of weak institutions. Over the last 5 years, as Christine said, we have withdrawn about 400 banking licenses. That's more than a third of all banks. The financial sector's resilience is not only about the health of the individual institutions. We were very lucky we didn't have any major bubbles in the market in 2014. Just a year before, unsecured retail lending was growing at an excessive rate of 60% year on year. A highly dangerous situation we managed to resolve with macroprudential measures. Had we not started cleaning up the banking sector and dealt with runaway lending, we would have faced much more severe problems. In terms of volatility, many emerging markets faced another serious concern. Their financial institutions often have a high level of FX lending. In this situation, central banks face a dilemma. They need to allow the exchange rate to adjust while ensuring that the financial system with excessive FX exposure remains stable. It's not always easy to find the right combination of tools to preserve financial stability and curb inflation. We had this trade-off too. When we hiked the key rate, we restrained inflation by stabilizing the exchange rate and dampening aggregate demand. At the same time, this rate hike, along with currency depreciation, increased the risk of a systemic banking crisis through the spike of interest rate effects and credit risks on the bank's balance sheets. We have to account for the weak balance sheets of quite a few banks that have not built sufficient capital buffers. We used forbearance measures to buy them time to adjust. One of the measures allowed the banks to calculate their regulatory ratios using a notion of fixed exchange rate for 15 months. Unsurprisingly, many of the banks wanted this holiday period to continue indefinitely. Throughout that period, we took steps to convince the banks that forbearance was only temporary and that the policy of strengthening regulation supervision would be maintained in order to guarantee the financial sector's resilience. The government, for its part, introduced a banking stabilization program. Both state and privately owned banks were able to participate. That program really helped the banks and their clients come down. Nonetheless, these measures were not able to solve all of the problems. Many emerging markets face a problem of excessive external corporate borrowings. Large part of these loans can be sourced directly from global markets. For example, at the end of 2014, the Russian market was deeply concerned about corporate massive debt repayments coming due when we were shut up of international market. That concern was one of the reasons market volatility spiked. Unfortunately, central banks do not have enough macroprudential tools to influence corporate borrowing. This is a financial stability issue which central banks need to address together with governments. In Russia, we are currently discussing whether it's worth introducing something like DTI, debt to income, for corporate lending into banking regulation. Many banks also had to address the growing problem of FX borrowers who did not have export-based FX revenues and failed to make their payments. NPLs were particularly high in such cases. We began to stimulate banks to decrease the share of FX lending and FX deposits on their balance sheets. Such measures include higher risk weights for FX loans and higher reserve requirements for FX deposits. While we appreciate the IMF has frowned on this in the past, we found it to be very useful. Let us get back to our policy elements. Item 3 on my list is the issue of central bank independence and coordination. In emerging markets countries with mostly weak institutions, the independence of the central bank is only trusted after it's tested. While Russia's central bank is independent by law, the legal test of its independence came in 2014. That's when we took decisive action despite strong criticism from many in business, society, and even in the government. Our opponents did not always behave nicely. For example, one businessman asked me if we had come from outer space. I suggested it was a good time to send us back. Many thought that inflation target was the start of science fiction. We have to be consistent in implementing and communicating our policy to gain the market confidence. That made risk premiums go down, making the job of managing volatility easier for us. You can measure that in the yield curve. For a couple of years, it was inverted. Until recently, it was flat because the market trusts our ability to decrease inflation. Even after the recent geopolitical shocks, Russia's long-term rates are not all that different than those of the countries with similar inflation targets. I hope I am not jinxing anything. I should say gaining the market's trust once doesn't guarantee that you will always have it in the future. That trust gets retested every time there is a crisis. Meanwhile, central bank independence should not lead to the lack of coordination with the government. Yes, we have our own lanes, our own areas of responsibility, but the governments and central banks need to take into consideration measures introduced by the other party. Coordination with fiscal policy is especially important. Fiscal dominance is a major problem for many central banks. Thankfully, Russia is in a relatively good position on that front. We have a new and very strict fiscal audit. when oil prices are above $40 a barrel, we will put the excess income into our reserves. Budget consolidation has helped a lot in achieving our goals. These measures have not only improved macro stability, but have also contributed to reduction in the exchange rate volatility. But of course, fiscal buffers decrease the probability of currency crisis in the future. The central bank's communication policy can also be a very important tool for gaining trust and anchoring inflation expectations. We had to change our approach to communication significantly over the last several years in order to build market trust. In the past, the Bank of Russia rarely explained or announced its actions. In fact, the central bank rarely said anything at all. With inflation targeting, we had to develop the various tools for communicating to increase the market and general public's understanding of what we were doing. I remember one episode from 2014 particularly well. When we raised the key rate to 17%, the information about our decision was published late at night. The following day, the markets were very nervous. They thought because it was announced in the middle of the night, it must have been taken in time. All kinds of rumors started to circulate. But answer why we did it at night was actually very simple. Russia has 11 time zones, and we needed the banks in the Far East hours and hours ahead of Moscow to know the new rate before they opened their doors. Needless to say, we didn't communicate our rationale very well. Since then, we developed a whole set of communication tools, fixed times to key monetary policy releases, regular meetings with journalists, analysts and investors, press conferences, interviews, social media outreach, financial literacy website, and so on. Of course, all of that sounds pretty standard, and it's after all the standard for communication for a modern central bank. But it wasn't standard for us, and we have spent a lot of time building on that system. First, we needed people to acknowledge, okay, we understand what you are saying. Our task now is to get them to say, we believe you and we trust your judgment. Despite the several shocks, the Russian economy has adjusted rather quickly, thanks at least in part to these four elements of policy. The economy contracted 3.6% in the wake of the 2014 crisis, three times less than what we saw during the great financial crisis. The balance of payments adjusted as well. The current account surplus is now our expectations for this year, about 5% of GDP. Drastic financial consolidation reduced the budget's break-even price for oil to $60 a barrel from $100. Corporate debt levels are normal. Household debt is quite low and public debt is very low. Unemployment is at historically low level and close to the natural unemployment rate. Now it's 4.7%. Inflation, meanwhile, was brought down to 2.5% by the end of last year. It is now on its way back to our 4% target. Although inflation has been below our target for the last few quarters, the Bank of Russia hasn't rushed to cut rates. We need to keep our monetary policy relatively tight to control current internal and external risks to inflation. Growth at the same time is between 1.5% and 2%, in line with our estimations for potential growth, but it is still too low. Like everywhere else, monetary policy can only do so much in Russia. It cannot increase potential growth. Potential growth to low level is Russia's main domestic challenge. Structural policies must address economic diversification as well as the issues related to our aging population and improved productivity. These highly needed structural policies, fiscal policies, could have an impact on monetary policy. The Russian government, for example, has recently announced a number of fiscal initiatives. The expectation is that they will have a positive supply side effect. At the same time, measures like a hike in VAT could prompt inflationary pressure, which can in turn amplify inflationary pressure from external shocks. If that happens, our monetary policy will have to remain tight, but may even get tighter. We believe that our monetary policy does not have any material negative effect on economic growth, because the main restraints, that they have huge challenges. For example, it's not easy for them to live in a low inflation environment. They used to live in the environment with high inflation and margins very high, where they should reorganize their business models to be more cost effective because of low inflation. They should increase their productivity, and that's why they have a lot of challenges with financial technologies, with competition, so with technology companies.
So you will have in response to those challenges. Well, Madam Governor, you certainly
of the structural nature. Moreover, our low inflation rate policy is stabilizing market, consumer and business confidence. This positive externality offsets the negative effect of tightness. This is why we believe that the sacrifice ratio in Russia was close to zero. Structural changes, fiscal consolidation, and cautious monetary policy are interrelated parts of domestic economic policy. But as an open economy with a big share of international commerce in GDP and with an open capital income, Russia is not immune to external shocks. Russia's economy's three biggest external risks are related to oil, policy normalization, and geopolitics. The first two are well known and expected risk factors, and we have taken precautionary measures for them. Geopolitical events, not only sanctions, but also trade wars and potential currency wars, are different. They are much less predictable and subject to contagion, and spillover effects, which are often not clear ahead to them. It forces us to build even more buffers. We are in an interconnected world where trade measures against one country or sanctions against one company can have global effects. And when countries need to answer by building outsized buffers, it can become a drag on the global economy. I believe that we should at least discuss these issues in a similar manner as we discuss monetary policies through us. To conclude my lecture, I would like to reiterate the thesis I made at the beginning. Our experience shows that inflation targeting in an emerging market country can be an essential part of the financial stability framework, but it needs to be augmented by volatility management instruments and buffers. All of these, the IT framework, its instruments, are well known and widely implemented. They are commonplace. The trick lies in getting their application right, getting their combination, exact doses, and timing correct. All decisions need to be adjusted to local market conditions and specific shocks. We central bankers tend to construct policy with ready-made bricks and pieces, like we are building something with Lego. But modern policy making and its constituent parts are very different from the level you know. It's a lot more like the level equivalent we had when I was a kid in the Soviet Union. The bricks were imperfect, and to get them to fit together, you had to make manual improvements. Cutting angles, and drilling holes, and so on. Sticking to the analogy, central bankers need to be flexible, not only when it comes to choosing the parts, but in reshaping them to better fit local market composition. That said, once a policy framework has been decided, there is no room for compromise, especially in volatile times, where there are constant risks to financial stability. If there is one thing I learned over the last 5 years, we must be persistent and consistent. Thank you very much for your time.
Said, you remember some of the previous central bank governors They were very terrible, can't say obscure. And you are, hopefully, will be more practical. I have to say that you are an absolute perfect combination of cerebral and practical, so well done. That was fascinating. Thank you. I promised Elvira one thing. I will not speak too fast, because I can't speak Russian. While Elvira masters English language quite well, it's not your normal way of expressing yourself. So I will speak slowly and I will too fast to just... I want to take you back to 2013, must have been June or July, when the president, whom you've been advising for a year, asks you if you're prepared to become the governor of the Central Bank of Russia. You know the situation because you're familiar with the Russian economy. You know that a lot of work has to be done in relation to the banking sector, cancelling licenses, closing down banks, doing hard things. A former deputy governor of the Central Bank of Russia has been assassinated by a former banker. You know that the situation is dire. You don't have that many tools. And you know that monetary policy needs to be redefined. How does it feel?
At 2013 was very different. When I first presented my speech, I was making my speech to the parliament, the parliament's report for my person as a governor, I said that my task would be easier because I said that I will ease monetary policy, lower interest rates, because the situation was quite stable. I knew that the banking system required a lot of improvements. It required strengthening of rules, of supervision. It was clear that banking sector is not in good shape. It was absolutely undercapitalized with bad practices, with money laundering institutions, and that's why I thought that it would be my focus, not monetary policy. But the first challenges were not only policy in 2013. But hopefully, the Bank of Russia has done a lot of work to prepare inflation targeting, because the inflation targeting first was announced in 2006. It was a very long preparation, very slow. We need to accelerate this work, for example, to introduce key rate, policy rate, for one rate that can anchor all rates in the economy. But it was quite interesting work, and really I would like once again to thank IMF staff because you provided us a lot of international experience of countries that made the same thing. It was very practical.
I know you have here two key players. Mr. Thompson,
Mr. Thompson
was very active, and David Lipton paid a few very significant trips to Russia at the time to provide all the support that we could, and the whole MCM department was certainly tasked to give support to this very society. Mm-hmm. There is a moment when you must have said, okay, we are moving, we're going ahead with inflation policy.
Well, it was in 2014. Maybe you
so
never.
So far, you're going down by then.
Before this decline in oil prices. It was just after taper tantrum. And we experienced this volatility time because of taper tantrum. And our ruble was under pressure. And it was evident that we should accelerate our movement to inflation targeting. But it was promised to complete this inflation targeting by the end of 2014. We did it maybe 2 months ahead of the schedule.
So you had volatility. The crisis of oil is looming, although not completely ongoing, but you decide to go ahead with inflation policy.
Mm-hmm.
What today you know, reflecting on those last 5 years, what advice would you give to central bank governors in emerging market economies that are also facing, as we know, volatility, pressure, and who are wondering whether they're doing the right things?
I think that the most important thing is to have buffers.
Buffers in what?
And not have imbalances.
Okay, great imbalances.
And buffers. Different types of buffers. international reserves, foreign buffers, fiscal buffers. It's very important. And you make all of the imbalances. As you said, keep your house in order, to fix the roof while the sun is shining. And even if the roof is leaky, you should continue fixing it even if it starts raining. You cannot postpone it. In case of Russia, we created a lot of buffers. But even with buffers, we don't feel in absolutely safe place, because the volatility of the movement of capital flows, we are the country with rare country, emerging market countries with open capital account. And that's why we should be prepared with this volatility, and that's why I think it's very important to have these tested instruments to manage volatility of foreign currency. To have tested instruments, to have infrastructure to conduct some operations, and to have resources to provide foreign currency to market. It's not intervention in a standard way. It's not to target the level of currency. It's only to smooth the volatility. But we are very cautious with these instruments, exactly for that reason. When we switched to the floating regime, markets were for a long time very suspicious about if we really switch to the floating regime or not. And even the operations to smooth the volatility, these interventions can be considered as the
going back
to the old regime. That's why we need to be more cautious than other emerging markets in using this instrument.
So how did you convince them that yes, you were serious about that, yes, you were predictable, and you would even be orthodox? I heard you say that earlier today, by being orthodox.
We only continue explaining our goals, and all our goals.
That takes me to communication skills. Because you changed the communication pattern of the Central Bank of Russia. Before you, there was not a lot of communication. And you did open the doors, the windows, and you used social media. How did you frame that? And what language do you use with the financial experts and with the markets and with the analysts who you see regularly? And how do you communicate with the Russian, now much more financially literate than they were?
It's one of the challenges to communicate rightly with markets, with professionals. And I think we have quite good contact with them. Sometimes they think that our actions could be explained better, that we should be more predictable. But general public is quite challenging because we need to adapt our language. To make our language more accessible for them. The general public start to adjust to our explanations in that times. And it's good for the general public cannot even notice our existence. But in that times we should be very careful. That's why we use different channels. One of the challenges is recent increasing importance of social media. And we know that general public trusts the social media even more than, for example, professionals. But that's why we see that, and that's why we should communicate properly through social media as well. We try to do this. And there are one more challenge in communication policy is related to forward guidance, because markets get accustomed to forward guidance by large central banks. They expect from other central banks to have some commitments about monetary policy, about policy rates. They think that it's more predictable. We try to explain more about our logic, how we interpret data, what factors are important to make those decisions. But nevertheless, markets want some predictions of our policy. The central banks, I'm sure, should keep some flexibility to react to our circumstances, to be predictable but flexible. It's not easy in communications with markets. It's very important not to be hostages of the markets, but to be transparent and predictable for them.
So you can provide some forward guidance, but only so much so that you can vary from.
We provide some types of forward guidance. It's the guidance of the stance of our policy, but there's a lot of caveats. But we can change if something happens in the economy, if our forecasts are revised, we can signal the market that we can change it. For example, recently we stopped our easing policy because of the work of new factors, internal and external factors, and we said that we will continue the risk of the line.
You mentioned many buffers, and one of them is fiscal buffer, macroprudential buffers. You also mentioned the fact that there has to be some cooperation with the fiscal authorities. How does it work in practice? How do you operate with the Minister of Finance and the other authorities while securing and maintaining your independence, which you have also mentioned?
The independence doesn't mean that there is no conversation, there is no coordination, there is no speaking with the Minister of Finance. We discuss the situation in the economy, our vision of this situation. It's more about the exchange of information.
So you don't go and knock on the door of Minister Silvanov to say, what are you doing with your fiscal policy?
It's their responsibility. But we are happy that...
And he doesn't do that with you. There.
But we are happy that they conduct this policy of financial consolidation. I think it's important in our country, this combination of cautious monetary policy and
fiscal surplus.
Fiscal surplus. We have paid current account surplus and fiscal surplus. I think it's quite big buffers.
Plus your fiscal rule, which was after a good debate between...
Maybe one bump on that we left. It's not the diversification of our economy. We have no structures out
there. Oil and gas.
Oil and gas. Even if it's declining now, but it's gas, we should diversify our economy, we should improve the productivity to have this structural buffer in our economy.
There's one area where Russian experts are quite famous, and that is math, sciences, physics, as well as computer sciences. I'm sure you have two computer sciences at the bank. We're looking at fintech, we're looking at virtual currencies. Is this something that we need and visit going forward, that central banks, including the Central Bank of Russia, actually launches its own virtual currency, as other central banks?
I think the central banks will create a virtual currency. It's some remote future. Uh-huh. Maybe it can be, but it's too early to think seriously about central bank virtual currency. But we are very cautious with this phenomenon of cryptocurrencies. I know that people like cryptocurrency as the reflection of new financial technologies. Mm-hmm. Indeed, financial technologies are great. The technology which is the basis of cryptocurrency, distributed ledger, is very promising technology. It's not quite mature. But I see more disadvantages of cryptocurrency. It's for more. It's very volatile asset. Mm-hmm. And it's more volatile than the most volatile financial assets that we know. That's why the issue of consumer protections, investment protections is very important. It can be used for money laundering. We can see it's not none of the technologies that cannot secure us from cybersecurity, from cyber crime.
Are you concerned about cybersecurity?
Yes, of course. Yes, of course. We pay a lot of attention to improve all the systems of cybersecurity in the financial system. I think it's very important. That's why in the cryptocurrency is attractive for people who want quick money. They should understand that they can lose this money. But we think we should think about why this is so attractive for people. It's not only for money laundering and other things. It's fast, it's quite cost effective. It can smooth transactions between countries. That's why we should develop these types of services that are very attractive for people. It's the point that we should think about.
You would certainly not please the originators of Bitcoins and others who wanted to do away with central banks and organize their own flows and transactions.
But about central bank digital money, it's too early, I think. Because we don't know the impact of this on the banking sector as a whole, where central bank should be the only provider of money, how it can influence financial stability. It's very unknown territory. We should more analyze this than before taking decisions.
You mentioned de-dollarization. And this is certainly an area where Russia has demonstrated its achievement. What are the main lessons that Russia can draw from that de-dollarization, particularly concerning the private sector?
De-dollarization is a very difficult process. Mm-hmm. We have a very high level of de-dollarization in the 90s. It was about 70%. And then in 2000, the realization can start declining. But the first reason was the stable currency, even the shaping currency.
Was all about that confidence?
Now, with flexible currency, we should base the realization process on low inflation. It's not easy because the people's mind is more concentrated on currency than on the level of inflation. But it's changing. Mm-hmm. That's why we try to implement additional measures to stimulate banks to this de-dollarization. So we have different coefficient risks for currency lending. We have current reserve requirements for foreign deposits. We see that it has effect on the banking system. And now we have this trend of de-dollarization.
Okay, so you associate risk-weighted principles to currency-denominated instruments.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Um, was going to ask you something about the board. You have an unusual board. 12 members, 5 women. Very unusual.
Yes, it is. The third problem in some events were related to that's why we had to draw so many practices. But the positive effect of this activity is that remaining events, they are strong. They created real capital, they created big reserves, buffers. That's why I think now we have quite a stable situation and the resilience of financial system has increased a lot. But we'll continue this work. It's very important to keep this level of regulation and supervision.
Oh, that has to require you.
We should be. They ask us, and we answer them, that we should create a partnership and some consultative dialogue type supervision. Okay. Okay. You understand?